IOC representative to the Philippines, Mikee Cojuangco-Jaworski, is beaming with pride as she is the first Filipino Asian to become a member of the executive board of the International Olympic Committee. To know more about the role, Mikee joins us on ANC. All right, so just to define the role, it's been a big news a couple of days ago that you being a newly elected member of the IOC. But technically, what is the role of being a member of the executive board for the IOC?
Well, I think the best way for me to describe it is to liken it really to a corporation, and then you are part of that board of directors of that corporation that makes the decisions for the corporation, whether it's the administrative side, the policy side, and next moves. And then, of course, later on, it has to still be ratified by the IOC session, which means the bigger body of IOC members.
Is there a definitive role now for you? I'm looking at the Olympics website, the IOC website, and there are too many technical responsibilities. But at least from the first parts of your election, is there already a definite role for you?
Well, you know, I still keep my roles on my different commissions. So I still continue my role as the chairperson of the Education Commission. I'm still on the Tokyo 2020 Coordination Commission, the Paris 2024 Coordination Commission, and the Olympic Channel Commission. But there's one commission that I've been removed from, which is the future host of the Olympiad Commission. And that was the commission that accepts the bids of the countries who want to host the Olympics. And it's the commission that also communicates with the different countries to try and guide them with their different bids.
Mikee, what was the process of nomination and election?
Actually, I filed my candidacy. It's not a position that you get nominated for, although you need to get endorsed by a number of your colleagues. So basically, you inform the body that you're intending to run for office. Of course, there's a campaign. And then the official announcement or the official submission of your candidacy, the deadline is 2 days before the elections. And then you have to be nominated by five of your colleagues. And then your candidacy is accepted, and then there's an election.
Let's focus on the task ahead. 2021, we spoke a few months ago, and there has been pros on savings, and there's been pros also on making use of the resources. Supposed to be now, right? Around this time, it's supposed to be Tokyo 2020, move to 2021. But what is it? What are the tasks at hand? From your knowledge?
As far as Tokyo is
2021,
concerned.
Yes, Tokyo is concerned.
So, okay, we're still calling them the Tokyo 2020 Olympics. And right now, all the scenarios are being looked at on how we need to run the games, the different ways in which we might have to run the games, depending on what the situation is like leading up to it. So a lot of study is being put into that, a lot of coordination with the WHO. Obviously, the government of the city of Tokyo is spearheading this, and the government of Tokyo is in full support of having the games. Of course, a few months ago, we heard Prime Minister Abe say that he wants to be able to hold the games in its full form, but there's a very big possibility that that's not going to happen. That's why the different scenarios are being looked at. But at the same time, there have been huge milestones because all the venues for the games and for the media centers and for the athletes' village, they've been secured. And this is really, really, it's a huge task because these are all owned by different entities, both private and government. And you can just imagine that there were already different activities scheduled in those different venues for next year, which is everyone thought the Tokyo Games would be finished by then. So there are very important tasks like this that have been completed and with full support of the government of Japan. The tickets also, if you bought a ticket and you can't make it next year, you can get a refund. But if you bought a ticket, it's still valid for next year. So it's the first time in history that there's ever been a postponement. Actually, it would have been so much easier for everyone to say, cancel na lang, wala na lang. But, well, you know, everyone was also really focused on the athletes and that a lot of these athletes won't have the same opportunity or ability to compete in 4 years' time. So that was the priority then. And now the main priority is really safety and health of all the participants, whether athletes, officials, spectators. That's main priority.
Now for context, Mikee, when we talk about this, articles have blown up for the past few days. But for context, gaano ba to kalaki? What is the impact of a Filipina, first Filipino-Asian to be part of the board?
Well, so everyone is saying, and I guess it's true that we've made history because there's never been an Asian woman on the IOC executive board. And, well, I'm not sure if my colleagues were really thinking of that. But for me, as far as I'm concerned, it's such an honor. It's so, I don't know how to describe it, you know. It's, we're told in the IOC that our duties there are global, but you can't really help it. You also bring to the table your experiences, where you come from. And yes, I'm Asian and so proud to be one. So, I hope that other Asian women see this as something of a milestone for themselves. And I think, you know, we just have to focus on our jobs. We just have to try to do our jobs as best as we can. We just have to respect our colleagues and build good relationships with them, because you also are able to achieve more when you have good relationships with your colleagues. So I think, you know, it's I think I've just described the Olympic values of friendship, respect, and excellence. And I think when you find joy in working in this way, I think people also want to see you do well. So it's something. It's a title. Tama ba yon? Is it a title for a woman? It's a title that I'm so proud to hold.
I'm sure that there have been many texts and messages of congratulations, but you know, your election to the IOC Executive Board, it's also technical. And I'm sure there have been misconceptions along the way. What are those, and what are those that you want to clear out?
Well, I've been asked a lot, like, so what's your first project gonna be? And I've had to say, well, I'm sorry, no, it doesn't work that way. It's not like I'm elected onto the Executive Board and then I can take on a pet project. There are IOC members that have been given special assignments, but even non-members of EB have been given assignments like that. And it's really me being part of the decision-making body of more information. I know that more time and more serious study will be expected of me. There will definitely be a benefit to Philippine sports, but not in the sense that we would have more funding or more projects or, you know, more of these things, this kind of things. So I've often had to be reminded by my seniors in the IOC that I'm the IOC representative to the Philippines. I'm not the Philippine representative to the IOC. Kasi nakakahalata siguro sila. I really try to implement the things that I see, the things that I learn, the best practices. And when I see other countries succeeding, I really try to share it locally, to share the information, to share the mechanics of how things are done abroad. And, you know, it's also similar to my own athletic career, when I shifted to coaching, I would tell my students, you know, I'm trying to teach you because I went through years and years of experience, but if you can do in 10 years what I did in 20, then, you know, we've already improved the next generation of athletes. And I'm hoping that somehow that can be applied to sport administration.
Lastly, Mikee, I know your goal with the IOC, this position should be objective, fair, unbiased. But indirectly, yeah, I have to ask this. How do you think that this role will be an impact to Philippine sports?
Well, okay, for one thing, the decisions that we would have to make as a board, and that's why it's a team. That's why it's a team of 15 people, not just actually 15, because we're also relying on the IOC administration, the directors of the different departments within the IOC, and the experts at the specific jobs that they do to provide us with the proper information for us to be able to make these objective decisions and forward-looking decisions. As far as Philippine sports is concerned, I will always, always continue to bring home what I learned. I will always try to be a part of the success of Philippine sports. I'll always try to see how I might be able to make connections between Philippine sports and everything that I do abroad. But also, it's a two-way street. I can keep trying to bring things home, and it's like a gift. But if you don't open the gift and you don't use the gift, then I don't know how we can benefit from those things. So it's not just now that I'm part of the executive board. It's been that way since I got the chance to be exposed to international sport administration ever since I became a member of the IOC. But I think it's obvious that there's more of a chance for that now. So I'm in a better position, a stronger position to do my job as an IOC member, because at the core, that's still what I am. I am still an IOC member. It's just that now I've been given a bigger responsibility.
Congratulations, newly elected IOC Executive Board Member Mikee Cojuangco-Jaworski, for joining us here on ANC.
Thanks, Mikee. It's always a pleasure.